Become a sustaining member of the Commonwealth Club for just $10 a month. Join today.
Welcome to the Commonwealth Club. I'm George Hammond, chair of the Humanities Forum, which organized tonight's event. It's tonight in Germany, that is, and that's where we're directly live streaming this from, Frankfurt, Germany, and in San Francisco, of course. I'd like to welcome our online audiences, our virtual audiences, and for all those who listen to it on our YouTube channel later. This is one of over 400 programs we've done since COVID-19 has begun without an audience, trying to bring you as many of the ideas as we can that we're used to doing right here in San Francisco live. So tonight we have Sabine Hossenfelder, a theoretical physicist who works at the Frankfurt Institute for Advanced Study. And she is a research fellow in the superfluid dark matter group. She's also a very early adopter of YouTube. She started her channel in 2007 and has over 250,000 subscribers and over 17 million views. Just for the perspective of the people who are Commonwealth Club members, the Commonwealth Club, with 400 to 500 speakers a year, also adopted the YouTube channel in 2007. And after all these years, we have 90 some thousand subscribers and 15 million viewers. So Sabine, you have done just as well as the entire club has in the time. So that's a very impressive. And you speak all about lots of different topics, but it's almost all about physics, other than your singing, which is a great side bit. So I want to read something. We're going to start at the latest news in theoretical physics, which is, of course, the research about the muon and whether the muon is upsetting things, because in the articles about this, whether, you know, this muon research at Fermilab is going to upset the standard model. Several times I came across this quote. Sabine Hossenfelder, a physicist at the Frankfurt Institute for Advanced Study, tweeted, "Of course the possibility exists that it's new physics, but I wouldn't bet on it." So why not? Why wouldn't you bet on this having an effect on new physics?
Well, maybe to give you some context, this anomaly has been there for 20 years. And so it's basically been with me throughout my whole career, and I've had some time to think about it. And the thing with the muon G minus 2 anomaly is that it's pitching an experiment against a terribly complicated calculation in the standard model of particle physics, and they're just, you know, there are many things that can go wrong with this calculation. And there have always been some parts in this calculation that have been kind of suspicious, mm-hmm. that people have tried to improve upon. And I suspect what's going on is that someone somewhere along the line is underestimating the uncertainty. So the uncertainty on the theoretical prediction is just too small, which is why the theoretical prediction is outside the measurement result.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's an interesting thing for outsiders to watch. I mean, you in your book, Lost in Math, How Beauty Leads Physics Astray, I thought, first of all, this is a nice repeat of something the ancient Greek philosophers discussed, which is, what do we pursue, beauty or truth? It's beauty versus truth, and you're basically coming down all these years later in the physics area on that we should not let beauty lead us astray. And you have a lot of great examples of it, and you talk about the standard model of fundamental particle physics and the fact that that hasn't made much progress in the last few decades. And you wonder whether it's this obsession with beauty which is getting in the way. One question I have about that is both of the famous recent ones, besides the muon, the Higgs boson, they're both particles that disintegrate fairly rapidly. And so it's kind of interesting why they're in a group of fundamental particles, because fundamental particles aren't supposed to disintegrate into smaller pieces, right? I mean, they're supposed to be the fundamental pieces that everything is built from. Or do I have that wrong?
Well, they don't disintegrate. They decay into other particles, and in a nutshell, the reason is that they're too massive. So they can decay into particles with smaller mass, and that's what they do. But they're still fundamental particles in the sense that they're not them. They don't have a substructure, so they can decay, but they're not made of smaller things. At least not for all we presently know. You know, it could always be that at some point we'll find some. But actually, you know, in particle physics term, the muon is a long-lived particle. You know, it's no comparison to the Higgs boson. So measuring something with the muon is vastly easier than measuring something with the Higgs.
You said something very interesting. You said that it decays into other particles, but it's not made of something else. Isn't the decay into something which is also fundamental particles? It doesn't mean that it was made up of those particles in the first place?
No, it doesn't. It's what the decay means is that it interacts with those particles. So you can also, in principle, have the same process backwards. Mm-hmm. It's like you know, if you have a path that forks. Mm-hmm. That's basically how we describe it in terms of Feynman diagrams. So you have one particle coming in and then two particles coming out, but you could have come in from any path to the junction and go out in the two other ends. So all these possible iterations actually do occur in nature. It's just that some of them are more likely than others. So the heavy particles are likely to decay into lighter ones, basically is because entropy increase.
For our listeners, something a little bit more that they're used to. how does that sort of analysis compare to, say, water made up of hydrogen and oxygen? Both hydrogen and oxygen are atoms. They're pretty long-lasting atoms, and even when they come together in water, that's a fairly long-lasting molecule. But what you're saying is that water is not really made up of, or not if the analogy were correct. It's not, but if the analogy were correct, is it like water is made up of or decays into hydrogen and oxygen, and hydrogen and oxygen can also go in the reverse order and become water, as opposed to that water is made up of it? I'm using it as an analogy because I understand that it's not accurate about water, but in the case of these fundamental particles that are more massive, it would seem that you could look at it both ways. So there's a reason why not looking at it that way, right?
Yeah, you're right. I understand that it can be confusing. So, I mean, to begin with, water, luckily, usually doesn't just decay, right? but the thing is, with water, with a water molecule, we can actually see the substructure. Like if you do a spectral graph or something like this, so you can actually tell it's not one homogeneous blob or something. And that's exactly what we don't see for the elementary particles. As I said, for all we currently can tell, they don't have any substructure. That's why we call them elementary.
Got it. Now, that goes back. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But I'm going to go back to what we know. First of all, I want to talk about what you find uncomfortable about the current ideas that makes you doubt them or makes you wonder where we're going to go with them. And then I'd like to go back to what we really do know, and atomic theory, I think, is one of those things. So we'll go back to the Greeks in a little while. But one of the things that you talk about is fine-tuned versus natural in analyzing theories. And I thought it was a really great analysis for people who aren't familiar with that. Could you explain why that approach, which is related to the beauty, your beauty argument, why it makes you feel uncomfortable about what's going on?
Yeah, so maybe I should start with briefly explaining what all this talk about naturalness and fine-tuning is about. Mm-hmm. So in theoretical physics, we deal with theories that are basically pieces of mathematics. Mm-hmm. And we use those to make predictions, for example, for the decay rate of some particles, stuff like that. And these theories all contain parameters, and some of those are dimensionless. which, so they don't have units, they're just numbers. And all these dimensionless numbers in the theories are supposed to be of order one, so which means close by one, but not exactly one, not very large, not very small. Mm-hmm. If that's the case, then the theory is called natural. So that's the definition. And theoretical physicists like theories that are natural, and I call this a particular type of beauty. Mm-hmm. And so a theory that's fine-tuned is just a theory that isn't natural. So the idea is that you have to pick a particular number very, very precisely. Like, say you have a small number that's 0.00003 or something. The idea is that you would have to, you know, finely tune it to this 0.0003. That's where the idea comes from. And now the thing is that fine-tuning arguments can be good arguments in certain circumstances. If you know, the usual example would be a pencil balance on its tip. You would find that very unnatural in the sense that you would have to very finely tune the position of the pen and all the motions of the air molecules around it, that kind of thing. And you would correctly conclude the probability that the pen just happens to be balanced on its pencil, happens to be balanced on its tip, is vanishingly small. Therefore, it's very likely it's held in place by something. Mm-hmm. So that's how a good argument from naturalness or fine-tuning works. Now, the problem in the foundations of physics is that people use these fine-tuning arguments for cases where you cannot possibly know anything about the probability distribution. Mm-hmm. So when we're talking about the constants of nature that appear in these theories, so we might be talking about, say, the fine structure constant or the mass of the Higgs boson, that kind of thing, then we just can't make any statements about whether or not that particular value of the constant is likely. Mm-hmm. And that's why I say these arguments are not scientific arguments. Mm-hmm. And if they're not scientific arguments, well, then what are they? So, you know, some people have told me, well, they're metaphysical criteria. Philosophically, that's probably the right word to use. But I call them arguments from beauty, because that's, I think, the way that physicists think about them, and also where they originally came from.
Well, you, in talking about those theories and different possibilities, you make a really good point that there's no proof for any theory. People in the popular press throw around the word proof all the time. And I know scientists perfectly understand this, but I think it's good for the rest of the people to understand proof is only in a few areas in mathematics. There is no physical theory that's ever been proven. There's been reliable evidence that we should keep looking in this direction. Maybe explain the distinction there a little bit to people, so that this idea that scientists don't believe in anything is proven about any of these theories.
Yeah, of course, it's somewhat an issue about the colloquial use of language. You know, if we colloquially use words like proof or truth, they don't mean exactly the same thing as we say in science. So I would say that really the only thing you can strictly speaking prove are mathematical relations. Mm-hmm. And that cannot contain any statements about nature. Mm-hmm. So if we have a theory of nature like the standard model, maybe, or the concordance model, which describes cosmology, that kind of thing, then we can collect evidence in favor of the theory. Mm-hmm. So we would say it's been well confirmed, but we will never ultimately be able to prove that the theory is actually correct. There could always be a next measurement that contradicts the theory, and then we'll have to go and look for a better theory. So that's how science works.
Yeah, in your book, you said on the opposite end of the proving, you said you cannot falsify a theory, but you can implausify it. And I think that's the other element of it. I think that's another thing to explain about how science approaches this. Maybe you can expand out a little bit on that idea.
Yeah, that's right. So there are some cases where you can actually falsify a theory, but they're very, very rare. Mm-hmm. Because if you get some kind of measurements that contradicts your original theory, you can always twiddle with the theory. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's something that scientists shouldn't do, but they do it all the time. And it's not necessarily wrong because you learn something from the measurement. So then you go back to the drawing board and you try to improve your theory. Mm-hmm. The problem is that what happens is that it makes the theories more and more complicated, more and more arcane, you could say. And at some point, what happens is that people just lose interest. If you have a theory that's been fixed over and over and over again, maybe like the thing with the epicycles, then it becomes increasingly less plausible. And in particular, if there's a better theory that explains the data simpler, then practitioners will just go over and start using the better theory.
Your use of your reference to the epicycle theory is at least something that a lot of people who pay attention to this, even from the outside, know about, as an example where the mathematics was ever more elaborate and fairly accurate in predicting where the planets were going. And that Copernicus, when he first tried to rearrange it, that his numbers were actually less accurate, or his math was less accurate until the elliptical idea. So maybe because everybody kind of uses that, why don't you explain it's a good example of where the math led in one direction and was more precise actually than the ideas coming back in another area.
Yeah, I mean, you already said it, so I'm not sure what we did. It's a good example of how big a difference a simplification can make, even though people at the time thought that ellipses are ugly, right? I mean, one of the major reasons they kept doing these cycles around cycles around cycles is that they had this idea that circles are the most perfect geometric shape that you can think of. Mm-hmm. And so certainly if you can do it with circles, then please do it with circles. But from what the calculation and effort is concerned, it just becomes very time consuming. So from a purely pragmatic point of view, it made sense to switch to ellipses. And I think today, you know, if you ask any astronomer, are ellipses ugly? They would just laugh at you, right? So our conception of beauty has entirely changed there.
Right. I think they would say it's much more beautiful because it's clear, more beautiful. I mean, it's what we're looking for, an answer. And I think when we're looking for an answer that makes a lot of sense is beautiful to us all right away. It's an interesting part of to go back to it again, the argument between beauty and truth. It's rather an extreme form of chutzpah to believe that our intuition and our ideas about beauty would be more accurate rather than trying to figure out what's really out there. And I think you bring up the point really well in your book about how scientists move in a direction, and within a certain amount of time, they're so emotionally attached to their theories or whatever that they always want that theory to win. It's a normal human thing, but it doesn't move us forward to trying to figure out what our reality is. I mean, we're all trying to share an understanding of our shared reality. It's not easy. But in any case, we have millions of people working on it now, and we're making more progress, it seems, more quickly. But some of the old ideas about how to go about it, emotional ideas, are there getting in our way. That's a great point that you made in your book. You mentioned, I think, Kurt Weill, maybe, was it? Or somebody who said that if it came down to an argument between beauty and truth, he would probably lean towards beauty in his decisions. And there are plenty of famous physicists like that. Another thing that you bring up in your book is you mentioned that Max Planck said, you know, over 100 years ago, that there are 25 orders of magnitude between what we can see and what he thought, anyway, the substantive reality was. Why don't you talk about that and how far we've progressed? Because you're talking about that we see the Higgs boson and the muon as homogeneous and undividable. But we're at what level of order of magnitude on that scale that he was talking about?
Yeah, that's right. So Max Planck had the great insight, you could say, that there's a particularly, I dare to say, natural set of units that you can assemble from the already known fundamental constants. And so those are now called the Planck units. Mm-hmm. There's a Planck mass, and there's a Planck time, and a Planck length. And so the reason that Max Planck introduced them was because, and that was literally his argument, aliens would also use them. You put that in the paper. And so because they're just composed of these fundamental constants that you can just extract from measurements. But their relevance today is that you can estimate at which energies or distances the effects of quantum gravity should become important, and that happens to be on the order of magnitude where the Planck energy is. Mm-hmm. And so that's about 15 orders of magnitude beyond what even the Large Hadron Collider can probe. So it's really a long, long way to go.
And you talk about this in other ways too, that okay, well, X-rays will take us so far, and then we need a different method because at that point it's to, you know, it's affecting things there on the same scale. The light waves are on the same scale as the photons. It reminded me that if you had a fundamental particle, and it really was the building block, then how would you see it? How would you look at it? Because we look at everything or perceive almost everything by throwing many, many smaller things at it and then having them bounce off. If we just think about our daily lives with photons bouncing off of us. So it would seem to me that we would always, the atom would always, or the, not the atom, but the fundamental particle would always be outside our reach because we'd only be able to throw another atom at it. That's the, if it's as small as it gets.
Well, so if we use something like the Large Hadron Collider, we don't throw atoms, but protons, right? So the Large Hadron Collider throws protons at protons. You can also do this with leptons if you want. So actually has an advantage because protons are themselves made of smaller particles. So protons are not fundamental. They're made up of quarks and gluons. Mm-hmm. So actually you're distributing the energy that you pump into the particle on all these subparticles. But the way that we're looking for new particles is that we just pump a lot of energy in that collision. Mm-hmm. And if you have an energy that's above the mass of the new particle that you're looking for, you have a chance to actually make it. Mm. And that's how particle colliders work. You just pump a lot of energy in a collision, and then everything that can happen will happen. And if there are new particles in that energy range, you'll see them. Probably not directly, in the sense that they'll decay long before they run into the detector. But you'll see the traces of the decay, and that's pretty much how all LHC physics works.
I used the word atom in a way that was just inaccurate. I was going back to the atomic theory and saying, if you have a fundamental particle that's indestructible as part of the theory, and it is the smallest thing that there is, whatever that is, we don't know, but we're looking at this one level with the protons and the quarks, etc. But whatever the fundamental level is, that would be that there would be nothing smaller than to take a look at it with. You wouldn't have anything to be able to perceive it with. So it seems to me that level is always going to be theoretically understandable, but not perceivable, or not, you would never get a collider that could do it because you have to, it's just a thought off to the side, because it seems like the smallest thing, we're so used to learning things by throwing many, many things at it and then getting the details. And if it's all the smallest thing, how would you ever be able to do that? It's just theoretically not possible, it seems like.
Well, so the thing is that if we are looking for particles that collide us, we actually don't see them directly, as I just said. So they could be very small. They can be smaller than the thing you're trying to probe them with. Like, it's kind of difficult to define a size for an elementary particle. But if you wish, in some sense, the Higgs boson is smaller than protons. So in some sense, we do see smaller particles with bigger ones by pumping that much energy into a small region of space-time.
Oh, great. I'll have to drop that argument then. In your analysis in your book, you also you gave a very good example, I thought, of where — this is a totally different subject — where special relativity and quantum mechanics have a problem. And you talk about the fact that in quantum mechanics there can be two locations, but because an electron — why don't you explain that? I thought that was one of the best explanations of why we're having trouble merging relativity theory and quantum mechanics, and everyone hears about that. So I think a good example is useful.
Yeah, right. I should put ahead, so the problem is that we have two different theories in the foundations of physics. One is Einstein's theory of general relativity, according to which gravity is caused by the curvature of space-time. So that's this whole story with the trampoline, with the Ben rubber sheet or what have you. So and that's what we call a classical theory or a non-quantum theory. And then we have the standard model of particle physics that we already talked about, where the particles have quantum properties. And that's a collection of different things. Most importantly, it's that they obey the uncertainty principle. So there are certain combinations of observables that you can't measure simultaneously. And then they can do weird things, like being in two places at the same time. Mm-hmm. Now, that brings up the following the following problem. If you have a particle like an electron, say, that is in two places at the same time, we know that the electron has a mass, so it has a gravitational pull. But if the particle is in two places, then where does the gravitational pull go? The gravitational theory that Einstein put forward just can't give us an answer because it doesn't have quantum properties. Mm-hmm. So it's an embarrassingly simple question, like what's the gravitational field of an electron in such a superposition? But we don't have an answer. The current theories just can't answer the question.
Right. And unless something changes in one or the other theory, it's not going to be answerable. If we go back a little bit to say we have these theories, and before I do that, in talking about this, one of the analogies that some physicists have used is that we're like creating a map about reality. I mean, obviously, if you had to reproduce reality, you'd have to recreate the entire universe. So what we're doing is sort of mapping what's going on, and trying to analyze it that way. And I was wondering, to what extent, because it's useful for calculations, et cetera, that the relativity theory and quantum mechanics are both a way of mapping things that we can't perceive directly, rather than an accurate idea about what's really happening. For example, quantum mechanics is about so many extremely small particles. And it seems one of the best methods we have of predicting what can come out of that. But we really don't know what's really happening in the individual cases that all add up to trillions of things that then we can quantify. So is quantum mechanics more like a map, or do people feel that it is an accurate description of the physical reality behind the trillions of projects that are going on?
I guess it depends on who you ask. the thing with quantum mechanics is that people can't agree on what it actually means. Mm-hmm. So I think what you may be alluding to with talking about maps is that you can have a purely instrumental perspective on what's going on with quantum mechanics. You know, it's just a mathematical mechanism, and you put in a question and out comes an answer, and then you go and measure it, and it agrees with the measurement, agrees with the prediction, and you can say, well, that's a good theory, and that's certainly the case. You know, just operationally, quantum mechanics is an extremely successful theory. Like, if you think back of the mu and g minus 2 that we talked about in the very beginning, so we're talking about this disagreement, but the maybe more remarkable thing is the stunning agreement between the theoretical prediction and the measurement up to the 10th digit after the point in this G minus 2. And then there's the 11th digit where, you know, they're
we're arguing, yeah.
That's off by a little bit. But I mean, to me, the remarkable part is that it works so dramatically well. So, and there's no doubt that it works well, but then there's the question, what does it actually mean? And that's where people disagree. So, as you say, it's not easy to just naively assign reality to the elements of quantum mechanics. Notably, that's the wave function, that thing that's normally denoted psi. That if you've ever read anything about quantum mechanics, you've seen psi.
Yeah.
So the psi is what we use to describe the system, which is just a vague word for whatever it is that we want to make a prediction for. So it could be, for example, your electron or the muon or, I don't know, the water molecule, something. So everything has a wave function. And now the weird thing about the wave function is that we can't observe it. We only observe the measurement outcome with a certain probability that is predicted by the wave function.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's really hard to assign reality to the wave function. It doesn't really make a terrible lot of sense. And there's been a lot of discussion starting the early days of quantum mechanics, just exactly what happens with the wave function if you don't look at it. so it's this old question, and Bohr was of the opinion, well, it's just a question that you're not supposed to ask.
Right.
And Einstein didn't like it, and then it went on like this for several decades. And basically, we're still asking the same question today.
Yeah. But we're used to that in other theories outside of science, where they don't look behind that door because we don't ask those questions. But obviously, science is supposed to be different than that. One of the things I think that the history of science is unclear, because people take the idea that we've made so much progress in the last 200 years in so many areas of science, especially in physics. I mean, the whole idea about what's going on in the universe is so much different than 200 years ago. And we're quite confident about it. It's not proven, but it's very reliable evidence that, you know, these stars are hundreds of millions of miles away, hundreds of millions of light years away from us, etc. So instead of a dome over the Earth, you know, we've gotten a pretty good idea about what's going on. And I don't know why it hasn't ruined astrology in the meantime, because that's supposed to be, you know, based upon the dome. But in any case, if you have that progress in any field, people get very overconfident about the ideas that they're doing because they're so successful. It happens in politics, it happens in science, it happens in anything. And so we're sitting here, and I think a useful function, you talk about the philosophical analysis being missing sometimes. A useful function is to look back at all the ideas that we've collected and how recently we've actually done those ideas. Now, there's one idea that's stayed a long time, which is the atomic theory. It's been around 2,500 years. There was no evidence for it other than thinking. But the idea was for this world to be discrete, there must be discrete particles that make it up, and there's an argument about it. And they must be homogeneous and so on. As we now talk about the fundamental particles we're looking at, we have pretty much the same criteria without saying that they're different shapes. So, So if that's the start, it takes a long time before we have another idea that's still fundamental in physics that's held on. Is there any other idea from prior to Newton and Copernicus and so on? Is there any other idea from ancient times that's other than the math that was done? But is there any other physics idea that as a concept is still intact? Because the ideas of motion, all that that Aristotle had, most of his stuff got overturned by new information.
Well, I guess it depends on where you start counting physics.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of the theories that we use are based on geometry in one way or the other,
right,
which is really, really ancient idea. And you could say we've just built up on that. But I mean, you know, on the other hand, you could say, well, that was mathematics. So right. It's a little bit ambiguous, I suppose.
Right. Okay, so for example, the idea that we have matter and energy, or that there's forces, that we divide up our reality into matter and energy, that idea is, 300-400 years old, something like that?
You're asking the wrong person.
Oh, okay, fine.
I'm a physicist and not a historian.
Okay, all right. So it just seems to me that some of these ideas, like forces, matter, energy, I look at matter and energy and I say, well, you know, we have an equation from Einstein that they are convertible into each other, and we work with that conversion. But it seems to me that if you had water was convertible from ice to water to water vapor and so on and so forth, that you would look for something more fundamental, like the molecule H2O that gives us the basis of this. And so when I see that equation, what I see is, maybe there's something more fundamental that looks like energy when it's going the speed of light relative to us and looks like mass otherwise. For example, neutrinos, for a long time, they were thought to be massless. But in the 90s, it was demonstrated that they actually had a very tiny amount of mass. So it seems to me that their speed relative to us maybe a factor, and that maybe another idea that's not either mass or energy might be more useful for arguing about this rather than talking about it from those concepts. But anyway, those concepts are relatively new, it's interesting that they stick with us, like force. We think there's some fundamental forces. There's four fundamental forces, or are there five now?
Yeah, by my counting, we're still at four.
We're still at four.
Though, I mean, I think that's a fair case to make that gravity isn't really a force. It's just that we are used to calling it a force, and in certain approximation, we can recover the force that Newton was talking about. But it's kind of the whole point of Einstein's general relativity is to say that gravity is not a force. It's just that space-time is curved, and we move in this curved space-time, and that makes it look like a force, but it's not really a force. But maybe, if I may, I want to add one thing about what you say about energy and mass and so on. So these are fairly old concepts, of course, but exactly what scientists mean by those words has only clarified, you know, over the course of centuries.
Right.
And, you know, to some extent, maybe we still don't entirely understand, especially what mass is. There's an argument to be had about this. But just because the word has been in use for a long time doesn't mean nothing's changed. And yeah. So about the energy and mass, so of course they are related by motion. So this equation that's often quoted, E equals MC squared, it misses a term that includes the momentum or the velocity, if you want to have a simpler explanation. So strictly speaking, it's a relation between the energy, the momentum, and the mass.
Mm-hmm.
So in some sense, if you take the energy and the velocity of the thing together, actually, you have to subtract it, but you get the mass or the invariant mass of the thing. So that's the idea behind Einstein's equations. So yes, these things are very closely related to each other, the motion of the energy and the mass.
And from what you just said, it made me understand that maybe that's how neutrinos were discovered to have mass, by focusing more on their fast momentum, that there was still something left over once you could measure it. Because at the time, you know, if you go back to the 70s, you know, neutrinos were considered massless, just like photons are considered massless. So that
right.
analysis using momentum made it clear that there was something left, just like we measure things precisely enough that now that we know by measuring more precisely, there's still something left, and that must be the invariant mass.
The evidence for the neutrino masses comes from elsewhere. But you're right that neutrinos were originally considered to be massless just because the mass is so small they couldn't measure it. The reason they came up with the idea that neutrinos or something like neutrinos had to exist was that energy and momentum are conserved quantities. Mm-hmm. And there were certain reactions which they saw where it wasn't conserved. And, you know, then you have the option. You can either throw out this conservation law, which screws up all of physics, basically, or you can conjecture a new particle that carries away the energy and momentum. And that's how the neutrino was originally introduced, I think, by Pauli, if I remember correctly. Mm-hmm. But then it took like 35 years or something for them to actually be able to measure it because it interacts so weakly. And since it's so light, they couldn't actually see any signs of it having a mass.
Mm-hmm.
The knowledge that they actually need to have mass comes from an entirely different phenomenon, mm-hmm. Which is the neutrino oscillation. So there are three different types of neutrino. There's one neutrino for each of the leptons. So there's mm-hmm. an electron neutrino and a muon neutrino and a tau neutrino. And those can change into each other. So that's called neutrino oscillation, and it's been observationally confirmed. But the thing is, this can only happen if the neutrinos have different masses.
Mm-hmm.
So even if you assume that one of them has zero mass, then the other ones need to have some mass. So that's how we know they need to have masses. We still don't really know what the absolute mass is. So strictly speaking, we only know the difference between the masses.
The differences. You mentioned, Pauli, the person who theorized that there must be neutrinos was a little embarrassed about it because it didn't, you know, right? I thought that it's always an interesting part of science. So he found it embarrassing because it just wasn't proved for a long time and wondered whether he just, you know, was a flight of fancy on his part. What about your area, dark matter? Give us a little bit of idea about how this idea arose and what's it based on and what the evidence is for it.
Yeah, so dark matter is a long-standing puzzle in astronomy, and it's been known since the 1930s.
Mm-hmm.
So the issue is that we have general relativity, and we have all these particles in the standard model, and we can combine them to make predictions for what we should see there in the cosmos, you know, how galaxies should look like, how they should behave, how structures should form, and so on and so forth. And what we actually see doesn't match with the prediction.
Mm-hmm.
And the first person to actually see this was Fritz Zwicky, who looked at galaxy clusters. So these are clusters of several hundred up to 1,000 or so galaxies that move around each other. So they're gravitationally bound. They're bound together by their own gravitational pull. And now the thing is that the average velocity of the galaxies in a cluster depends on the total mass in the cluster.
Mm-hmm.
So if you measure this average velocity, you can tell how much mass there is in the cluster. And Zwicky realized that there wasn't remotely enough mass that he could see that would also explain the velocities of the galaxies. And he said, well, there has to be something else in those clusters. And he called that dunkle materie, dark matter. Mm-hmm. And so this is where it came from. And then in the 60s, 70s, and so on, there were increasingly more observations, not from galaxy clusters, but also from galaxies where there's a similar issue. They rotate too fast. So this is where Vera Rubin left her mark. Mm-hmm. And I think around this time, people realize that it's a systematic thing. You know, if you observe one cluster and another cluster, you can say, well, maybe there's something odd with these clusters, mm-hmm. right? But so they came to realize that that's a very systematic thing. This happens everywhere. Mm-hmm. And so this idea of dark matter gradually solidified. And, you know, as astronomy advanced, there were more and more observations that fit to the pattern, mm-hmm. gravitational lenses, the cosmic microwave background, structure formation, and so on and so forth. And in all these cases, the idea that there is some dark matter which we can't see and that needs to have particular properties. For example, it shouldn't clump the same way that our normal matter clumps. That just wouldn't work. It has to form rather fluffy clouds or halos, as they're called. It worked quite well for a long time, but in the past, you know, 2-3 decades or something, it's become more difficult to make dark matter work just because the data has become better. Mm-hmm. So the shortcomings of this dark matter hypothesis have become more and more obvious. Mm-hmm.
You mentioned something in there that you also talk about in your book, which is the sort of fluffy clouds. That is that there's these spherical objects that have dense centers and less and less dense outer areas, but they're all connected with each other. It's all part of the same system. And it reminded me that when the atom was first described, it was kind of described as a little solar system, you know, and that was what they analogized it to. But then it was said, well, it's much more complicated than that. But if our solar system includes all of the fluffy parts of the cloud, which we see now, I mean, we can tell that there's a lot of dust, a lot of small particles, a lot of comets. There's all kinds of other things going on other than the planets in the simple structure. It makes me wonder whether that's not like one of the most fundamental structures that we have everywhere, no matter what the scale is, that there is, you know, the momentum at a dense core that spins other things around it, and it's always less and less dense outside of it, and that would be a good explanation or a good form. And I was wondering if that wouldn't give us an indication, since that's the form that takes place the most often, of what the give us some information about what the fundamental particles and how they behave are, because it seems to me it's the momentum of all those things merging the way it's described in a black hole, for example. It's not that dissimilar, even though it looks special. It looks particularly different. So that structure, the question, that structure, is that an inaccurate observation, or is that kind of structure the most basic thing at most levels?
So it's not a universal that you find in all forces. It depends on the force. So it just, if you think of an atom, then the force that's acting on the electrons is the electromagnetic force, which has this 1/r² law. And it's the same for the gravitational force. So they're actually quite similar. So in some sense, it's not really surprising that you would see similar structures. Mm-hmm. The reason in the end why atoms turn out to be more complicated than the solar system yeah. is that the quantum effects are just stronger because the whole thing is small. Mm-hmm. So Planck's constant comes in and kicks you and says, well, actually, you know, they're not little balls moving on orbits around it, but you right. have to take into account that it's a wave function. It's actually a blurry and has a probability distribution and blah, 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 all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But I mean, there are forces that work entirely differently. For example, the strong nuclear force. The strong nuclear force, you know, as the name says, is strong. but it has this weird property that's called asymptotic freedom, which means it actually becomes weaker at short distances, mm-hmm. or at high energies. So what happens if you take a constituent of the atomic nucleus, like say a proton or something like this, and you try to pull the constituents apart, like the quarks, they'll try to get back together. And you can try to describe this force acting between them. And the analogy that people usually use is that it's kind of like a rubber band. Mm-hmm. So you have this rubber band force that becomes increasingly stronger with the distance. And that's very, very different to how gravity works, where the force actually, it falls with 1/r². So it's an entirely different thing. And then at some point, basically what happens is that you have so much energy in this rubber band that it snaps and you just have two separate parts. And so that's called fragmentation, but maybe that's a detail. So it's actually this weird rubber bendery stringy structure that string theory was originally invented for, uh-huh. to describe these tubes. So what I'm trying to aim at is that this property which you've observed holds for the electromagnetic force and the gravitational force isn't generally true for all forces. We know exceptions to that.
How about if you tell us a little bit about what your day's like when you do your research in the superfluid dark matter? I mean, what are you working on right now, and sort of what is your group investigating?
Yeah, so lots of things, always lots of things. So we've been trying to find a good way to systematically use the idea of the superfluid to describe how it distributes in galaxies, basically. The idea is that at some point we might be able to tell at which stage in the history of galactic evolution the superfluid starts to condense. Mm-hmm. So I think that was pretty wild. Maybe I should start with giving you some background. So the whole idea with the superfluid dark matter, which is not originally mine, it was put forward by Justin Khoury and his group, is that you have a type of dark matter that condenses around galaxies and forms the superfluid in which there acts a new force that is mediated by the phonons in the superfluid. And that new force partly makes up for this effect that we normally assign to dark matter. Mm. And now you may wonder, well, why the heck would you want to do that? Isn't it enough if you have the gravitational force? But the thing is that, as I alluded to earlier, we have a lot of observations in astrophysics and cosmology where this idea of this halo dark matter, the normal theory that's called cold dark matter, mm-hmm. Doesn't quite work. And the brief summary of the problems is that there are more patterns, there's more structure in the data than we can explain with particle dark matter. Or, I mean, you can amend the theory to make it work. Right. That's what I mentioned earlier. You can't really falsify it. You can always kind of fumble it to fit the prediction, but the problem is that then it's no longer a simple explanation. Mm-hmm. And so this superfluid idea has the great benefit that it provides a simple explanation for the patterns that we see, mm-hmm. which to me makes it very appealing. But then the question is, how can you tell apart the superfluid dark matter from the normal cold dark matter? Mm-hmm. And one of the things that seemed promising to me is that you could look back into the history of galactic evolution. And if this idea with the superfluid is right, at some point you should see a change, mm-hmm. where this phase transition happens in the superfluid forms. And in a model with cold dark matter, there shouldn't be anything comparable. But to actually figure out exactly what happens and what are the observations, mm-hmm. That you should be looking for, you have to first understand how the theory works and how you calculate the pattern of the superfluid profile for arbitrary galaxies, spiral galaxies, elliptic galaxies, and so on and so forth. So that's what we're working on right now.
Let me see if I have this right. So we don't really have an idea. I mean, we have an idea about dark matter and what it should be accomplishing, but of course we haven't seen it. But now there's a superfluid state of it, and and superfluidity usually is under some kind of extreme circumstances when it's done for matter that we're used to. So you're working with this superfluidity in dark matter. What extreme circumstances or conditions are there that cause it to switch from its normal clumping, whatever, to a superfluid state? Have you figured that out, or are there theories about that?
So the stuff is already very cold, so it decouples very early in the early universe, and then it just cools and cools and cools. So it's ridiculously cold because it interacts very little with the normal matter, so it doesn't heat up. It's not like it's a sun or something. So
right.
It's just this really cold stuff that's sitting there. And what causes the phase transition is gravitational pressure. So it falls down in the gravitational potential, and the gravitational pressure increases. And somewhere on the size of galaxies, or at the strength of the gravitational potential that's caused by the galaxies, this phase transition has to happen. Like so this is basically, this is the assumption for this whole thing to work. So this phase transition has to be in the range that you get the superfluid in galaxies. Otherwise, it doesn't work. So that's the idea, basically. But yeah, I mean, you're asking the right question. What you would actually want to know is exactly the circumstances under which the phase transition happens, which is a hideously difficult question. Mm-hmm. Like, even for, you know, if you take one of the best understood superfluids, like helium maybe, or something mm-hmm. like this, you can't actually calculate where the phase transitions happen. Mm-hmm. It's mostly observational. And so we're trying to find a simple way to just parameterize what's happening. And then we can look at the data and try to figure out if the simple parameterization actually fits with the observations.
Do you guys ever finish a week of work and sit around and say, how did we get here in just 100 years that we can make these ideas about what's going on hundreds of millions of light years away from us and actually have enough evidence, et cetera, to try to figure that out? I mean, it's really quite astounding that we have enough information based on our assumptions about the information we're getting to be able to make those kind of predictions and then get a better theory, you know? It's not where we were 100 years ago.
Yeah, I flip-flop back between it's so super amazing that we can do all this stuff and why are we so dumb that we can't do anything better? I think there's nothing in between, seemingly.
No, that's the kind of, conflict that keeps everybody going, the kind of friction that keeps everybody going between these two concepts, right? Between, wow, it's so fantastic, but how come we can't be better? Speaking of that, you end your book, or you're near the end of the book, you say, what does Sabina want to know? You know, I mean, I want to know, how did the universe begin? Is time made up of moments? Right? You had a couple of questions that you said, these are the questions I would really like answered. Maybe those are the questions you had when you first went into physics. But you mentioned them near the end of your book, I think. This one of them, is time made up of moments? Obviously that idea has been argued for a couple thousand years too. Now we have, we're almost away from film, celluloid film now too. But the celluloid film was a way of capturing with 32 frames per second, something that looked like it was moving, but it really wasn't moving, and therefore could give some evidence that there was a series of time that could be just in moments, and that there really was no coordination between them, other than maybe some divine intervention or whatever. But it seems to me that idea really flies in the face of the conservation of energy and momentum, right? If how could it move from, how could that be true unless somebody is tricking us? If time is momentary, then someone's tricking us to make it look like it's not. And either way, that's not a good idea. I mean, one wouldn't want there to be a trickster in charge. It's much better if there's rules, at least as far as I'm concerned. When you ask that question, do you feel that there's any chance that it could just be made up of moments?
So those are the questions, I think I listed them in the beginning, that I was originally interested in. And so, you know, when I started thinking about physics, I've always wondered, like, how could you possibly be able to tell the difference? Like, if time was made of very, very short moments, mm-hmm. and if it's actually really continuous. And so today I would say that this idea that time is made of discrete moments, you know, of a finite period, is very, very difficult to make compatible with Einstein's theories mm-hmm. of special and general relativity, which are very, very well confirmed. And I've worked on this for a bit. You know, there are theories in which space is discrete and in which time is discrete, in which both space and time are discrete. And I've pretty much given up on them. So, And yes, energy conservation is an issue in all these theories, basically, because in a nutshell, the continuity of time is very strongly related with energy conservation. Mm-hmm. But also in this case, I mean, you can ask how well have we actually measured that energy is really, really conserved? Mm-hmm. Like, can't you just say, well, maybe it's such a small violation of energy conservation that we wouldn't have measured it so far? Mm-hmm. And you know, that's a starting point. In the end, if you walk it through, I think it doesn't work. So at least personally, you know, that's the conclusion that I've come to.
And when we talk about time, to me, of course, we're used to thinking of time the way we've divided it up in minutes, seconds, and milliseconds, etc. But it seems to me our arbitrary measurement of the continuum of change. And the continuum of change is fairly easy to understand, more easy to understand in that there's quadrillions of particles all moving in different directions at the same time, and there's no way to, at least with the conservation of momentum, et cetera, as you said, there's no way to stop the whole picture and then start it again and then stop the whole picture and start it again unless you put in all that energy each time, you know? Each time you'd have to kick the momentum of each of those quadrillions of particles. So what? Now that you've gotten past that major question, do you have any other questions that are at the top of your? I mean, obviously the dark matter questions, but do you have any other big questions that you're? Just for those of you who haven't seen her YouTube channel, she'll explain everything about a particular thing in 10 minutes and make it much clearer than. If you're not a physicist, you'll be much clearer than it was before. You do a great job at that. So what is it that keeps your mind in the big picture wondering about, that keeps you moving on that, not just on the dark matter level, but on the whole thing of why you're still interested in physics and why you want to explain this to everybody as clearly as possible?
So one of the things that keeps me up at night is, we briefly talked about this earlier, is like, what's up with this wave function? You know, what's yeah. really going on in quantum mechanics? Because to me, it's just such a, we know it's an element of nature, right? We know that something about it is right, but we also know that this doesn't quite work. Mm-hmm. There has to be something else. And so this is also something that I'm working on. Like, can we finally maybe please make sense of quantum mechanics?
Well, to go to the wave-particle duality theory, which has been around for a long time, trying to make sense of photons and radiation, if we backed away from our solar system so that we were far enough, the Earth is spinning, and it's also going around the sun, and wouldn't that look like, if you were far enough away, wouldn't the Earth going around the sun look more like a wave function rather than an ellipse around the sun?
No, the wave function wouldn't look like that. I made a video.
It wouldn't look
that.
Like a wave function.
No, it wouldn't. It's just that, you see, the physics isn't scale invariant. So the actual physical masses and sizes of things make a difference. Mm-hmm. An atom is really different to the solar system.
Yeah.
So if you were to calculate the wave function for an electron or something, you would actually find it has these really blurry orbits that come in shells or mm-hmm. in you know, different belts or something like this. Whereas the Earth is really a fairly localized object that actually pretty much exactly moves on a path. And just by going away from the solar system, you wouldn't change anything about this.
About that function. All right, well, we're near the end, but just as an example of how things have changed, when I was in college, so this is 1973, one of my friends was getting his PhD in physics at the time, and he was using one of the new big computers, because John Kemeny was one of the founders of BASIC, was the president of our school, so they had given him a big computer, and this PhD student was using it. And he was calculating just what you were talking about. Where would the electrons be in an aluminum atom under certain circumstances? And the program that he wrote to make each calculation required 20 hours of running on the computer to come up with one of those locations. I'm sure it could be done on an iPhone today, I'm guessing, but maybe that's an exaggeration, but pretty close. And that's, you know, well within my lifetime. We're talking about 50 years ago. So obviously the changes are going to keep going on. The cooler tools that we have, the more we're going to be able to keep, you know, getting those fine things. So what are you hoping to see as a last question? What are you hoping to see get answered, you know, sooner rather than later? Like in the next 10 years, do you think of anything in physics as we're going to breach that and make progress in a particular area?
So I certainly hope that we will finally see evidence that gravity is actually quantized. Maybe not in 10 years, but 20, I think, is reasonable. So hopefully within my lifetime, if mm-hmm. I'm lucky. So I think that's kind of on the horizon. So I'm quite optimistic about this. Of course, I also hope that we will finally figure out what dark matter is. Though I suspect it might take a little longer. It's just a multifaceted problem with all these different observations that it's really, really difficult.
Not to mention, the only way we can observe it is from far, far away. I mean, you know, nothing. Is there anything on Earth that you observe that helps you understand dark matter, or is it just based on observations of galactic behavior?
Well, that depends what it's made of, or you know, maybe it's not made of anything, but maybe it's a modification of gravity. But if it's made of something, like if it's a particle, in principle, you could actually detect the particles. Like there are lots of experiments that have looked for it; they haven't found anything. Mm-hmm. But it may just be we've done the wrong experiments. You know, maybe we should have been looking for something else.
All right. Well, we have just a couple of questions that came in. So why don't we do that here? Let's see. This comes from Professor Edward Frankel. I wonder what Professor Hossenfelder's view of this issue is. In a recent review of a book about Hawking by James Gleick, I was struck by this quote: "The theory of everything is a false idol. Why should the universe, which grows more gloriously complex the more we see, be reducible to one set of equations and formula? The point of science is not the holy grail, but the quest, the searching and the asking." So do you think that is or do you think that the theory of everything or an answer is really the holy grail and we should go for it?
Well, yes and no. So we should definitely go for it, but it's not the holy grail. So this term theory of everything it has been, you know, it's very inaccurate. Physicists on the foundation of physics mean something very specific with it, which is that it combines gravity with the standard model and unifies the forces in the standard model. It does not, as the name suggests, actually explain everything. Mm-hmm. In the sense that for most practical purposes, it would be utterly useless. Like, I mean, if you want to develop a vaccine, just to name a completely random example, right, that theory of everything would be totally, utterly useless.
Yeah.
But I mean, we know, as I said, that there's something wrong with just throwing together general relativity with the standard model. So we need something more. And that's why I think a quest for theory of everything is reasonable, and we certainly should go after it.
Yeah, it's one of the things that I find interesting, the whole field of scientific and philosophical endeavor that's based on reason, that is that we're trying to get as close an idea about reality as we can get for us to apply ourselves, you know, better. And now that we have millions of people working on it instead of 10 or 15, if you go back 2,000 years, we're making progress in lots of fields. And I find it very interesting where you can take a whole field and say the metaphysical structure in which we explain life is irrelevant to this whole area. And we can figure out everything we need to know, even about our personalities, for example, or something like that, regardless of whether we were created or not created, or whether we, you know, all the different possibilities. We can find the patterns, because all the patterns that are most useful are part of our every moment reality. It's inherent in what's going on, and therefore should be useful regardless of what the superstructure is. But the superstructure, the clearer that gets, the easier it is, I think, to clarify the different pieces of it. So I liked your answer to the theory of everything. We still go for it, but the quest is the fun, is obviously the fun part. And we've made so much progress in such a short amount of time. Let's hope that millions of more people get involved in it, and we get even faster along the line. So thank you very much, Sabine, for joining us from Frankfurt, Germany. It was a great pleasure talking to you, and let us know if that answer about dark matter comes up while you're still alive. Thanks again. And so ends another event at the Commonwealth Club in its 119th year of enlightened discussion. Thank you for joining us.